Okay, so today I'll be talking about this topic, continuous EEG monitoring in intensive care unit. So this could come possibly as a short note for exam as well. So this talk I gave it in Nagpur in September 2016 in one of the conference they had. So it was a neurocritical care conference in Nagpur, so where I gave the talk in 2016. So the topics that I would be covering is just introduction about what we understand by continuous EEG, and whether continuous EEG is useful for detection of non-convulsive seizures and non-convulsive status epilepticus. So those are the terminology NCS and NCSC. And what are the risk factors for non-convulsive seizures and non-convulsive status epilepticus? And what is the recommended duration of monitoring? Sequelae of NCS and NCSC. So we'll talk a bit about ictal and interictal continuum and other indications for continuous EEG, and practical and technical consideration, cost effectiveness and summary. So these are all the topics that I would be covering in next 20 minutes. So when you look at EEG, I think the progress that has happened in EEG is acquisition of EEG has become easy. So storage of EEG also has become easy, electronical storage, and EEG could be monitored and interpreted in a remote with a remote review of the EEG. So all these three features of the EEG has led to evolution of continuous EEG. So what EEG helps us to determine is quantitative EEG has helped us to determine the number of seizures that a patient would develop in intensive care over a period of time, and it helps us to understand the long-term trends with regard to the seizure episodes. So the reason why there has been a renewed emphasis on continuous EEG, as so people could ask as to how is it continuous EEG different to EEG. So when there is a continuous recording of a EEG, it increases the sensitivity of one's ability to pick up non-convulsive seizures in ICU, and our ability to pick up non-convulsive status epilepticus increases in the intensive care unit. And continuous EEG also helps us to monitor treatment of these two entities that tend to be under-recognized in intensive care. And continuous EEG also helps to ascertain the sedation level of a patient in intensive care. And it helps one to distinguish between the true seizure and a pseudo seizure, or the presence or absence of seizure. So it helps us to at least identify patients who may have true seizures, or identify patients who may not be having seizures but they are in an altered sensorium. And in addition to that, continuous EEG helps us to look at the dynamic functions in any cerebral insult. Like if there is a cerebral ischemia, it helps us to ascertain the progression by monitoring and early detection of ischemic changes. So it has a role in even looking at the dynamic changes after an insult to the brain. So, but there are controversies revolving around continuous EEG. So there are different entities that tend to occur, which we do not know for sure whether we call it as a seizure or not. So there are rhythmic and periodic patterns. So I will come to it later. So we call it as periodic epileptiform lateralized discharges. So we do not know whether these discharges, one would call it as a seizure, and what is its significance, and whether we would be treating this. So there are a lot of disturbance within the brain activity one would witness when you put them on continuous EEG. So which we call it as periodic epileptiform discharges. They come under category of PED, periodic epileptiform discharges. So we do not know for sure whether these are abnormalities one should recognize and one should act upon. So that is a controversy in this particular area. And these are some of the changes which were previously undetected. So these could be only detected with continuous EEG. Okay. So the question we have is continuous EEG for the detection of non-convulsive seizures. Why continuous EEG? So one may ask, can we just do a EEG and recognize these seizures? Why is it that we need a continuous EEG? Because what has been recognized is non-convulsive seizures occur in 8 to 48% of the patients who are in coma. So any patient who comes to ICU who is in a deep coma, so we may ordinarily label them as coma, but in fact they may be having underlying non-convulsive seizures, which we wouldn't identify if we do not do a continuous EEG. And that leads to diagnostic delay can happen up to 24 hours because the patient is not waking up. You may do multiple tests, but the fact remains that there may be underlying seizures that may be happening. So there may be diagnostic delays by not putting them on continuous EEG. So this was a study from Drislon et al. So where they showed in patients where there was absolutely no suspicion of seizures, 88% of the seizures were picked up when they were put on continuous EEG in patients who were in altered sensorium or who were in coma. Okay. So the conventional EEG, what we do 30 to 60 minutes recording of EEG, and that has shown to miss seizures in 40 to 50% of the patients. So this was another study by Pandian et al, which came from US group. So this compared what is the pickup rate of conventional EEG and continuous EEG. So this study was done in 105 patients. If you see with conventional EEG with a recording of 30 minutes, only 11% seizures were picked up. But with continuous EEG, which was done for 2.9 days, 27% were picked up who had seizures, underlying seizures. Okay. So this was another study which came from the Indian group, Narayanan et al. This was done in 210 patients who were in altered mental status. So when they did a conventional EEG for 60 minutes recording, 55% were found to have ongoing seizure. But the rest of 45% who had seizures were picked up by continuous EEG for 12 to 24 hours. So this is the value of doing continuous EEG, where you can pick up seizures in a patient which would otherwise be missed in 30 or 60 minute recording of EEG. And in pediatrics, the continuous EEG has shown to double up your detection rate of non-convulsive seizures in pediatrics. Okay. So now the question one has to ask is, who should we monitor in ICU for continuous EEG? Do you monitor all patients or any specific subgroup you have to monitor? So what the literature suggests is the people or the patients who are at highest risk for seizures for non-convulsive seizures or non-convulsive status are the ones who are in altered mental status or who are in coma or who have had traumatic brain injury. So this is the subgroup of patients which would benefit from continuous EEG because these are the patients where underlying NCS or NCSC would be missed. And status epilepticus, I think 50% of the patients with status epilepticus, we would not know whether they have come to baseline unless you do continuous EEG. Although you would have treated them with benzodiazepines, so whether the seizure is completely aborted, just because they do not have motor movements, it doesn't mean they do not have seizure. So putting them on continuous EEG would help you to determine whether the seizures is completely abated or still are they at any risk. And these are the other subgroup of patients who are at a risk of NCS or NCSC, patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage, neuroinfections or intracranial hemorrhage. Although they may not have evident seizures, 20% of them may be at a risk of developing NCS or NCSC. And any of these patients who have had status epilepticus or any of these conditions, where there is a fluctuating mental status, that should raise an alarm that possible underlying NCS or NCSC could be prevalent. So in neonates and children, 7 to 46% of the children would be at a risk for underlying NCS. So the risk factors in children are any children with anoxia or hypoxia or children who's had history of seizure in the past, who have had infections or any metabolic abnormalities or TBI. So any structural injury to the brain in adults or in the pediatrics, if they have fluctuating mental status or if their sensorium is not improving, so these are the patients who are at a potential risk of having underlying NCS or NCSC. Okay. And in pediatrics, this was a study by Narayanan et al, which came in India, where one could identify the kids who are at a risk by looking at the subtle signs like eye movements, any nystagmoid movements of the eye or any abnormal eye movements or changes in the pupillary diameter or any abnormal motor movements. I think these are the patients one would benefit from continuous EEG, where 32% of them would be at a risk of developing NCS or NCSC. So this slide essentially tells you which are the patients you would identify as someone who would benefit from continuous EEG. So anyone with structural injury or pediatrics with any of these problems or any of the subtle abnormal movements that we would see, I think these are the patients who qualify for continuous EEG. So now the question remains, how long should we monitor with continuous? Once you put them on continuous EEG, is there any time frame we monitor? So this comes from this study by Klassen et al, which came from the US group. So when you put a patient on continuous EEG, within first hour, 56% of them were found to have underlying NCS. So when you continued this for 12 to 24 hours, the pickup rate became 88%, and 24 to 48 hours, pickup rate was 93%. So and then it came down. So what this slide essentially tells from this study is, so your ability to pick up seizures would be there up to 48 hours, because your ability to recognize the underlying NCS would increase up to 48 hours. But if you do only for 1 hour, your pickup rate is almost half. Okay, so this was a subgroup of patients who were in coma. So when patients are in coma, I think your ability to pick up patients with underlying NCS lasted up to 48 to 168 hours. So if someone is in coma, maybe it is an indication we should monitor them for much longer than 48 hours, because still they may be at a risk of developing underlying NCS. So the conclusions they made from this study was, if patient is not in coma, it is reasonable to do continuous EEG for 24 hours or maybe up to 48 hours. But if patient is in coma, then it is recommended that we monitor continuous EEG for 48 to 72 hours. And that increases the sensitivity to 90%. And as I mentioned, if patient has PLED, PLED is periodic lateralized epileptiform discharges, then continuous EEG should be done for more than 24 hours. Okay. So what are the implications and treatment of NCS and NCSC? So what we have understood is non-convulsive status and non-convulsive status epilepticus, both obviously, intuitively we would know it increases the morbidity and mortality. And another important thing we understand is, so what your NCS or NCSC indicates to you when there is a intracranial hematoma is whether it is a cause or an effect. The reason why we say that is whether the seizure is occurring due to the expansion of hematoma or midline shift, or it's the other way. Seizure has happened and whether that is leading to your worsening brain edema. So we do not know for sure, but definitely it indicates there is some changes happening within the brain when they have an intracranial hematoma or when there is a midline shift. So that is when your NCS or NCSC tends to corroborate. So by doing continuous EEG, and if they start having NCS, then you would know there are some changes happening within the brain, which may be the midline shift or worsening edema or the expansion of hematoma. And in animal studies, they have shown it had a direct bearing with the neuronal injury and cognitive impairment. So if someone with any of the structural lesions in the brain, when they have NCS, so that has a direct bearing on neuronal injury and cognitive impairment. And these have shown good correlation with increase in the neuron-specific enolase. And when they have NCS or NCSC, when you do cerebral microdialysis, you would see increase in the CSF lactate, pyruvate, and increase in the ICP. So it does correlate. So if you have underlying NCS, which is identified by your continuous EEG, it had a good correlation with increase of these agents, which tend to get released when there is a sort of hypoxic situation in the brain. Okay, so what it also helps us is to look at the treatment effect. So early recognition and treatment of NCS is definitely shown to reduce mortality. So that came from these two studies, one from a Dutch study and a US study. And it is even shown when there is a delay in diagnosing your NCS, so it had a direct bearing on mortality, morbidity. So basically what it really highlights is that we have to be in the pursuit of identifying underlying NCS, because we miss it, then it has a direct bearing on mortality and morbidity. And we do not know whether all these NCS or underlying NCS-C has to be treated, so we need more prospective trials to determine whether what are all the patients who should be put on continuous EEG, and whether we treat all these NCS NCS. So you will see in the next slide, because we would talk about there are certain conditions where there is a controversy whether we treat or not. So all that come under a group of PED, periodic epileptiform discharges. So this particular slide will talk about that. So there are a lot of patients, when you put them on continuous EEG, we get something, some discharges which come under the category of periodic lateralized epileptiform discharges. And this may be physiological or this may be pathological, and we do not know for sure whether these have to be treated. So we do not know the implication of these discharges that gets witnessed in when you put them on continuous EEG. And there is another entity called global periodic epileptiform discharges. And all these two things, global periodic epileptiform discharges and periodic lateralized epileptiform discharges, come under this whole group called periodic epileptiform discharges. And as I said, we do not know whether this is a cause or effect, whether this is leading to NCS or whether this is leading to the deterioration, or is there a natural deterioration of the underlying brain pathology which is leading to PED. So we do not know. That's a controversy. And we do not know for sure whether these discharges need to be treated with benzodiazepines or anti-epileptic drugs. So there is controversy again whether you treat this with benzodiazepine or you treat them with anti-epileptic drugs. But what has been shown is, when someone has periodic epileptiform discharges with an underlying condition of subarachnoid hemorrhage, intracranial hematoma, anoxia, so we know they have bad prognosis. So any discharges would lead to bad prognosis, but we do not know for sure whether we should be treating this or not. So there is something called delta activity, which also are a sort of an unclear discharges. So this delta activity can be focal, lateralized or general rhythmic, and these are also known to be associated with poor prognosis. I'll show in the next slide. So what we understand by ictal interictal continuum is, so when there is a seizure which is very obvious and evident, we are sure, but this area, I think everything gets blurred and nebulous. We do not know whether it is cause or effect, whether these discharges which we witness, which come under category of PLED, should we be treating or not. So this becomes the gray area, so which we are little unsure. So what about the other indications for continuous EEG? I think monitoring response to treatment and sedation, I think continuous EEG can be used to monitor sedation level. And continuous EEG can be used to titrate to burst suppression. So when obviously you are giving sedation and your target is to achieve burst suppression, when you are using propofol sedation or benzodiazepines or barbiturates. So I think titrating to burst suppression, you need a continuous EEG monitoring. And continuous EEG could be used to titrate to reduce ICP, because if your ICPs are increasing, you can deepen the sedation with the help of continuous EEG to see if it can be customized to reduce your ICP. And what your continuous EEG helps is to optimize your sedation so that you are not giving more sedation or less sedation. So it helps you in that. And continuous EEG also helps in prognosis in post cardiac arrest and who is on therapeutic hypothermia, because we know in post cardiac arrest with hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, if they have this isoelectric pattern, which is a flat line, then you know pretty much they will not improve. So, and when patients are on therapeutic hypothermia, you would be putting them on paralysis and sedation. So it is very hard to determine how their neurological status is for 24 to 36 hours. So continuous EEG in that sense helps you to identify. Along with this, when someone has developed hypoxic ischemia, they can have underlying NCS, non-convulsive seizures. So by putting them on continuous EEG, you will be able to identify if there is underlying NCS or NCSC that is happening post cardiac arrest. And in patients with hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, your continuous EEG will help you to stratify and identify patients with underlying status epilepticus, which may be associated with poor outcome. And early detection of status epilepticus in hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy and treating them has shown to improve outcome that came from this study from Switzerland, Rossetti et al. So typically what happens if someone comes with post cardiac arrest and hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, so we would at the end of 72 hours we prognosticate, we see if they do not improve, then we know that they are unlikely to survive. But there are certain subgroup of patients who may not have improved because of underlying seizures. So if you are able to identify them with your continuous EEG, treat them, they may have favorable outcome. That was shown in this particular study from Switzerland. So prognosis. So EEG also helps in prognosis. So in status epilepticus, EEG normalization was associated with favorable outcome. So that was shown in this US study. So in patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage and moderate traumatic brain injury, if you have any of these discharges, global periodic epileptiform discharges or periodic epileptiform discharges or non-convulsive status epilepticus, so any of these are present in patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage or moderate TBI within 24 hours, they were associated with poor outcome. So this was shown from the studies from Italy, Canada and Switzerland. So, is continuous EEG useful for ischemia monitoring? So, it has been shown that continuous EEG is extremely sensitive to identify abnormalities in the cerebral blood flow. So, in a patient where cerebral blood flow falls, in patients with cerebral ischemia, if cerebral blood flow falls less than 25 to 30 ml per 100 grams per minute, so continuous EEG, what they witness or what is manifested is there is absence of fast frequency waves. So when you see there is an absence of fast frequency, so that determines that there is a fall in the cerebral blood flow. And after there is a fall in the fast frequency or absence of fast frequency, then you will start seeing slow frequency waves. And this slow frequency waves is what will identify that cerebral blood flow is diminished and ensuing cerebral ischemia is happening. So this is where it helps you in identifying delayed cerebral ischemia. Okay. So they looked at other variables, because continuous EEG from these two studies, they have tried to derive certain variables. So like total EEG power, relative alpha index and alpha divided by delta waves. So if any of these total EEG power is diminished and relative alpha index is diminished or alpha divided by delta waves, if any of these are diminished, it was shown to have good sensitivity and specificity to identify patients with delayed cerebral ischemia. Okay, so these are the derived variables in continuous EEG. When you see any of these getting diminished, so it identifies the patient at the risk for delayed cerebral ischemia. Or if you have patients with a slow frequency or absence of fast frequency, they also indicate that your cerebral blood flow is diminished and they are heading to cerebral ischemia. And what has been also shown is EEG identification of delayed cerebral ischemia, your ability to identify them precedes transcranial Doppler and cerebral angiogram. So it is much more better than transcranial Doppler and angiogram to identify patients with delayed cerebral ischemia. So what about continuous EEG for ischemia monitoring? So they come out with something called composite alpha index. So this particular tool was used in patients with grade 3 subarachnoid hemorrhage in around 12 patients, and they looked at composite alpha index. So it showed your ability to predict clinical deterioration improved from 40 to 67% when they monitored composite alpha index in continuous EEG, and your ability to predict patients who would improve, clinically improve, increased from 8 to 50%. So what basically this study showed is by putting a patient on continuous EEG and monitoring this helps you to better prognosticate patients whether they would improve or not improve. Okay. So there are certain limitations of continuous EEG. So artifacts can develop in ICU. So there can be state changes. State changes means they put the EEG leads on the scalp. So obviously when there is changes with its contact with the skin, so obviously the results could be erroneous or misinterpreted. And use of all the sedations do interfere with your interpretation of continuous EEG. So I think the conclusions of this particular continuous EEG is, I think we need more algorithm, decision-making algorithms for continuous EEG, which needs to be developed and tested prospectively to create homogeneity in the interpretation. Because there is a lot of heterogeneity in interpreting this continuous EEG. So there are certain practical and technical problems. So what is suggested is we should have a video EEG. So when you have a continuous EEG, so it should be monitored in a video, okay? And that helps to identify whether it is true seizure or artifact. So it has to be recorded on a video and then interpreted to identify whether it is really a true seizure or all that ictal, interictal spectrum, because all this GPED can be interpreted as seizures and then you may be ending up over-treating. And they say one should have a call alarm when patient needs any help when they have this, because some patients do have aura. And the call alarm will help you to identify and recognize and then notify to the EEG technicians that he may be having seizure. So we have done it in our ICU also. We have this continuous EEG where we give patient the alarm and they press the alarm when they perceive that they may have a seizure, and that will be recorded and interpreted. Okay. And it is suggested that the EEG leads, the continuous EEG should be MRI or CT compatible, because when these patients are moved to the CT or MRI, when they are put on EEG leads, we cannot remove the leads because then your continuum is lost. So they need to be MRI or CT compatible. And because of the state changes, I think there is a suggestion that subdermal wires can be used so that those leads are not displaced from the skin contact, and that also can lead to erroneous measurements. And these leads have to be maintained every 12 hourly. Nursing or the EEG technician should make sure that these leads are properly maintained. And the suggestion is, see, you can do continuous EEG with less than 16. So the full EEG needs 16 electrodes with two reference electrodes with a 20 monitoring system. So I think 16 electrodes is what is suggested for continuous EEG, because you could do it with lesser electrodes, but then the interpretation may not be very comprehensive. Okay. If you reduce, I think they have done a study, so this study from USA, when you reduce the montage means reduce the number of electrodes and the reference electrodes, you can miss 28% of the underlying NCS or NCSC. Okay. And it is suggested that EEG technician should be present 24 hours. For interpreting your continuous EEG. And EEG has to be reviewed by a competent neurologist or competent trained person every 12 hourly. When the patient is put on continuous EEG, interpretation should happen at least twice a day by a qualified person, and technician needs to be present for 24 hours. So now, having spoken about the role of continuous EEG and the utility and the practical, so is it cost effective? So we need to ask ourselves, by incorporating this in an ICU, would it be cost effective? So it has shown, by putting patient on continuous EEG, there was 44% reduction in the cost and median length of stay in patients who were in altered sensorium or coma. And what they found is changes in the clinical management happened in 52% of the time when they were put on continuous EEG. And anti-epileptic drugs were adjusted that many times because of the information that you got from continuous EEG. And it also helped you to discontinue anti-epileptic drugs where there was no seizures. So it did help in decision up to 52% of the times. And it helps, so these are the different studies, so helped in the changes in the clinical management up to 32% in one of the other study, and decision making impact happened up to 54% of the time. So these were the three studies which said yes, 30 to 50% was the range where there was a change in the clinical decision making and optimization of the anti-epileptic drugs. So I think the key important thing is we need more prospective multicentric studies to see whether it is going to be of really going to make any difference. The most important thing they have highlighted is the interpretation of continuous EEG, because you can put the patients on continuous EEG, but if you are not able to interpret it well, then obviously it does not lead to change in the outcome. Okay. And as I've already mentioned, this EEG, when you put a patient on continuous EEG, there's a lot of different things we see, and how we interpret it and the uniformity in interpreting these is what is needed. Because you may see real seizures, NCS or NCSE, which is straightforward, you would treat. Then you would see periodic epileptiform discharges, so this is a gray area. We do not know for sure whether should we be treating this or not. And you would see a lot of these rhythmic patterns, and we do not know how we should react to this. So there should be a uniform protocol which is a departmental wise to determine how we approach this interpretation. So to tackle this, in 2005, I think they formed a society called Critical Care EEG Monitoring Research Consortium, CCEMRC. So they tried to come up with a uniform guideline as to how we should tackle all these different findings that we would witness in continuous EEG. So they are coming with guidelines, and this is a group which is only looking at continuous EEG findings and trying to draw the guideline as to how we should be reacting to different findings that one would witness. So what are the future directions? So this was a survey done by the US group in 330 neurologists to see how much awareness they had about continuous EEG. So when they interviewed, or when they did a survey with 330 neurologists, what they said is, when they gave a questionnaire, 47% of them said monitoring should be done only for 24 hours in patients with coma. But we have understood from the literature it should be monitored for up to 48 hours. Okay. And in altered mental status also, they said 48% neurologists said that monitoring is enough for 24 hours. So which means there is lack of awareness even amongst neurologists about continuous EEG, because we should monitor for up to 48 hours or more, isn't it, in coma. And 16% of neurologists said monitoring for 1 hour is good enough. And 28% said 1 hour is good enough for altered mental status, again, which is a lack of knowledge or lack of awareness. And continuous EEG review. So as I said, review has to be done twice a day. So 27% of the people said once a day, 18% said should be done continuous fashion. Okay. So the Critical Care EEG Monitoring Research Consortium gets data from 22 hospitals globally where continuous EEG in ICU is practiced, and they are drawing guidelines in a periodic way. Okay. So then something about multimodality monitoring. So this is in a patient who is on an ICP catheter or ICP monitor, or patient who is undergoing microdialysis catheter. So they have suggested that dural electrodes can be placed directly on the brain to record the EEG and interpreted appropriately. So this is multimodality, where when there is already an ICP monitor or cerebral microdialysis, so placing EEG electrodes on the dura and recording continuous EEG is something that is also in practice. And in patients with traumatic brain injury with non-convulsive status, when they are on microdialysis, I think this study showed that they have increase in the lactate and pyruvate ratio. Obviously, lactate would go up whenever there is a seizure episode. And cerebral CSF lactate also, you would expect it to go. And that was demonstrated in this particular study. So the summary and take-home message is, I think continuous EEG is changing the current standards of care in ICU. Because I have to say this, because when I was coming back from Australia in around 2008, I think that is where our whole unit was getting equipped with the monitor for continuous EEG. And that was the time when all the patients with traumatic brain injury were meant to be put on continuous EEG, and all the nurses were being trained. This was in 2008 when I was coming back from Australia. That was the movement that was happening. So which means many places in the world are incorporating continuous EEG as a tool within ICU. So they are made compatible with the monitor, and nurses are trained, and any TBIs are put on continuous EEG to identify underlying NCS. TBI or patients with coma, patients with altered mental status or patients with any other intracranial hemorrhage or subarachnoid hemorrhage. So it is changing the way that we practice, in ICU. And what continuous EEG has shown to help is it gives information on prognosis, it gives information on the sedation level and the response to the treatment that is being given. And continuous EEG is recommended for 24 to 48 hours in altered mental status. And continuous EEG plus quantitative EEG helps you to identify patients, the number of seizures a patient would have, identify the long-term trends and identify patients with delayed cerebral ischemia. I think we need more research with regards to treatment effectiveness. And the key thing is, the most critical thing is standard interpretation of continuous EEG. I think everyone needs to be trained how to interpret the continuous EEG findings and what are all the features that one acts upon and what are all the features one need not act upon. And I think there is a research happening on automation versus individual review. I think this would make our life easy. So when there is an automated sort of a conclusion that comes, yes, this patient has NCS, or this patient has NCSE, or this patient has PED, then we know that what we need to do, rather than leaving it to each other's discretion to interpret the waveforms and identify, because intensivists, I would agree, would not be the experts in identifying these waveforms. Okay, so we need more prospective multicenter studies to see whether continuous EEG conclusively leads to better clinical outcomes. So thank you very much. So I end my talk with this quote: train your mind to see the good in every situation. Thank you.